Good afternoon, and welcome to our NPower Advancing Tech Careers Collaborative third quarter networking event. My name is Roland Selby, Vice President of Strategic Partnerships. Our topic tonight is the escalating demand for tech talent, and we have assembled a dynamic panel to discuss this topic. Before we begin the panel discussion, I want to share a little bit about NPower and who we are. We are a national nonprofit composed of mission-aligned and purpose-passionate people. Our desire is to provide a learning community for our veterans and young adults to gain professional skills and in-demand IT certifications that provide a gateway to the tech and tech-adjacent careers. NPower aligns our corporate partners, foundations, and other resources to assist with creating a diverse talent pool of job-ready young professionals to offer assistance with addressing the tech skills shortage. We provide our trainees with mentors and post-NPower support to start meaningful careers, earning family-sustaining wages and salaries. We assist transitioning military veterans and their spouses to earn IT certifications and create new career pathways. Last, we are all committed to breaking the cycles of poverty and creating new trajectories. It is my pleasure and honor to introduce our panel. Our moderator is Sean Martin, co-founder, operations and programming director of ITSP Magazine. John Miller, managing director, global head of cybersecurity services at Citi. Shawnee Waugh, global director, diversity business partner at Google. Larry Quinlan, principal and former global chief information officer with Deloitte. Avneet Hall, global threat analyst lead, vice president with Citi, and an NPower alumni. Sean, I will turn it over to you.
Fantastic, Roland, and thank you everybody for joining us today for this very important conversation. A quick word to say that I'm super grateful for everything that NPower does for the community, and I'm thrilled and honored to be leading this conversation with a great panel. So what does it take to hire, retain, upskill, and acquire diverse talent, perhaps from non-traditional backgrounds, removing the blinders, as I often like to say. And without further ado, I'm just going to get into it. We're going to look at retention, attrition, hiring, attracting, keeping folks happy and healthy in this new world where everything seems to be remote these days. Larry, I'm going to turn to you. There's no question we've seen an increase in attrition as individuals, employees, and companies try to navigate this new world of work from home, work remote, and as companies move back into the office, we're seeing a lot of challenges. What changes have you made to kind of strengthen that process, strengthen who you attract and how you attract new talent?
I think we're making tweaks more so than fundamental changes. And I've been in this business a long time and I've seen the ebbs and the flows. We've needed talent in certain spaces. Attrition has spiked and come down. It's always important to react, but I believe not to overreact. And I think there are lots of credible people out there who completely disagree with me, I'll admit. The thinking is this, that in a pandemic, people are really changing the way they think. Family dynamics change. Some people want to come to the office. Some people don't want to come to the office. Those dynamics create a certain amount of flux that result in attrition going. But we really have to look at the fundamentals of our business. Is it strong? Fundamentals of how we treat people. Do we treat them with respect? Are we good in inclusion? When you really look at the things that matter a lot to people, are we strong and are we providing for their needs and can we meet their aspirations? And that's what we think about most as an organization, as opposed to we're going to make 25 new changes because of the pandemic to assure our attrition rate goes from X to X. It's more long term. Are we a strong player that people really want to come to our organization, Deloitte, and our technology organization? And can we ride this out perhaps better than others can? And that's how we think about it.
Yeah, I love that, Larry. And certainly under action and over reaction. The extremes can be challenging, but that so the other extreme is to do nothing. And I want to turn to Avneet. Companies need to be cognizant of what's happening. They can't just let it happen to them. They can't let it happen to their employees. So what comes to mind when organizations need to create and implement policies that favor the individuals who might otherwise not have a choice in the matter? They're forced to come in, but they need that job. How should companies look at something like that?
Companies should be flexible because with COVID, you know, people are, they've been forced to be flexible. People are juggling childcare and work, juggling elderly care, caring for elderly parents, working from shared quarters. We've all faced those challenges, but people from low economic backgrounds, even more so to a degree we can't understand. So companies need to be cognizant of that and provide arrangements that help with that. Whether it even childcare, I mean, working women face a huge fight right now coming back into workforce. The amount of women that have left workforce in millions since COVID started, this is a crisis. So companies should look at, you know, can we provide childcare on site or somewhere near the family and other benefits that can really attract talent.
Yeah, and Shani, I want to turn to you because there's the standard pool of folks we tend to hire from at businesses. And I'm wondering, are we doing anything that's unknowingly excluding candidates from the hiring pool or even from advancement opportunities within that perhaps is forcing them to look elsewhere?
Yeah, thank you for that, Sean. You know, I think every organization has to look at their priorities and it ultimately, you know, informs their DEI strategy as well as their policies and procedures that they execute throughout the business. And the key to that is ensuring that you have the right information to be able to inform that DEI strategy. And so I don't know if anyone saw, but recently McKinsey did a study. For those of you who don't know, McKinsey is a global management consulting firm. And they did a study of 5,000 employees globally, as well as C-suite executives, to see where employees and executives are parked on workplace flexibility in the wake of the pandemic. And so executives want to get back to work very quickly and be in the office more days a week. So 3 or more days a week, you know, the study showed that that's where executives wanted the employee base to be. The employees had a very different take. They want to work from home 2 or more days a week. And so I think what the study shows is that there's a disconnect in what employees may want versus what employers are looking at. And if you're a company that's making policies based off of that, that goes against what employees are we focus on growing our workforce. How do we focus on supporting the communities that we work and live in, as well as how do we build inclusive products? And so we've had to do a number of things to even enhance our own hiring strategy to ensure that we're getting a more diverse candidate pool globally. So a couple of things that we've done, we have expanded our university reach. We've gone from 75 universities to 800 universities globally. From a retention standpoint, we've had to take a hard look at certain communities within our four walls and try to understand why certain groups were leaving faster than others. And were we doing things that were contrary to what they needed in the workplace? So I think there's a number of things that as employers move on, they learn from, right? You know, I will say Google, we don't say that we have all the answers, but the goal is to continuously make progress in these areas.
Yep. Fantastic. You know who has all the answers? John. I'm joking. No, but John, I'd like to get your thoughts on the topic of attrition and retention.
Yeah, listen, I mean, it's been a challenge, a significant one in the cybersecurity space, even prior to the pandemic. I think the pandemic is only going to continue to make this more of a challenge and really force us to be more creative. We spent a bit of time just now talking about, you know, how do we hire and how do we hire, you know, how do we be inclusive? And, you know, two big things that were helpful to improve my diversity numbers against my goals was to take a look at how we're writing these job descriptions. You know, we write these job descriptions, they're uber long, super boring, and it looks like you have to be a rocket scientist to know every single technology that's come out since, like, you know, 1982. And, you know, between the years of experience that are typically put there and the educational requirements, we're missing a lot of opportunity to go and hire people who actually have the practitioner level skills and the engineering skills that we need to work on the modern technologies we've implemented or want to implement. So really retooling those resumes, you know, even the wording that we use, right? The adjectives we use, the pronouns, you know, being more cognizant of and caring around that. When it comes to retaining people, people have a lot of options. And, you know, the surveys, the report that McKinsey did, it's very interesting in that, you know, if you're forcing people to go back in 3 days a week and it's something that they can't do, they're really not going to have a choice but to look elsewhere. Fortunately for them, I guess, there's a lot of opportunity out there. But that's gonna hurt long term. It really is gonna hurt long term. And you know, we wanna keep things interesting. We wanna give people opportunities to learn new skills. In the past, a lot of companies would just provide continuing education on the technical area that team focused in, and that was really kind of limiting people from learning the new things that they wanted to. So making training programs available where folks can, you know, be more cross-discipline, where they have not just one career path that's in front of them, but they have three or four that they can go down. So yeah, a lot of opportunity for us to do better in those spaces.
And there's no question. I mean, we hear that there's a gap, right? I'm almost tired of hearing that there's a gap because there are likely so many people available to fill this gap, yet somehow we're not making the connection. And we can point the finger and look at how we write the job descriptions, the way that automation pulls in the resumes and filters people out. We're not even looking in the right places. We have requirements on certifications and degrees and you name it. It's difficult to make that connection. And I want to turn to Avneet to hear a little bit about her story as an NPower graduate. And how did working with NPower enable you to present yourself, have the skills, find the connections, and ultimately get into a role that not only you can exceed and excel at, but actually enjoy as well?
I do. I really like my role. I like the culture where I work. I consider myself to be a pretty resourceful person, but I wouldn't be here without NPower. I'll be very honest. NPower gave me, you know, of course, there's certification preparation, a lot of skills, technical skills, but there's a lot of emphasis on soft skills, a lot of emphasis and training and feedback on how to improve yourself, even if you think you are a pretty hot shot. I don't need that, I don't need this, I don't need interview training. But going through NPower really gives you a lot of insights into yourself. And then, of course, NPower has an amazing network. Look at all these panelists on this call. All of these people are continuously speaking to NPower students. They are highly engaged. And these people and more, you know, many more are available to NPower students to talk to mentor. I did seek out such a person to be my mentor during my NPower, and that helped a lot. So, yes, it's... You know, and I don't see that access in many other campuses, even for many other students who are going through university programs. So it was very helpful.
And Larry, I'm gonna turn to you, and this is something that popped in my mind because there's training and having an aptitude and having a desire and a passion, but if the individual doesn't have the connection or the exposure, I saw some social media activity the other day that said, I'm trying to get a job, but everybody's asking me where I presented at a conference or or what CVV I've submitted. How do folks get awareness? How do they find the connections to find the right jobs?
It's a multifaceted question. A lot depends on the level. So, you know, an organization like NPower is so incredible because it actually substitutes a bit some of the exposure that's lacking with, it's almost a manufactured exposure. You join the NPower program, it's really cool. It puts you in touch with a number of organizations who otherwise might not have seen you. And that's part of the magic of it. So in addition to the preparation, which gets you ready for that stage, you actually get to be on the stage. And in many cases, you never would have found that stage on your own. Other people who occupy the stage would never have known that you existed. So this is part of the magic. Rather than simply putting the pressure on the individual saying, well, you know, you have to have had the exposure, you have to have done this, you must have done that, and simply then take a significant part of the population and cut them out. We're now saying, let's break down some of those artificial barriers, and with a program like NPowers, give people exposure, which then allows them to prove themselves. And that's what I love about it. Of course, at different levels in the organization, you then have to take personal responsibility for eminence. I tell people in my technology organization at the time, and they're sick and tired of hearing me saying it, you got to be famous for something. There's got to be a reason why we know who you are, why we want you on the team. Go get famous for something. It doesn't mean that's all you do, but spend time becoming famous for something, something that you're known for, something that you write about, something that people would say. We want her on the team.
And John, to you, before I go to Shani on this next point, what are you looking for that you're having a hard time finding? I mean, the threat landscape changed with the pandemic, the requirements for how you run the business and build your infrastructure have changed, and therefore the needs for your team have changed. How do you put the right job descriptions out there, and where do you find the right folks to fill that those positions?
Yeah, no, it's a tremendous challenge, and you know it's not just, you know, the working environment being remote. It's, you know, when you bring people on, are they the right kind of people that could assimilate and learn within the culture remotely without coming into the office? And how do we make sure that they have those human touch points as they come into the office? But that's if you find them, right? To your point. You know, for me, NPower has been a tremendous source of talent. I've had the opportunity to work with NPower for the last 12 years. And I was always very excited about the success of the students, watching them come out of these programs. They would do visits to our city offices, tour our security ops centers, our fusion centers. And what impressed me the most was just how inquisitive they were and the quality of their questions and their follow-up questions and then the follow-up questions. And really showed me, you know, how you know, experience without actually having, you know, in some cases that 4-year degree or prior 5 work years experience, they somehow picked up the experience, you know, to ask these very insightful questions. And really, as they came on as interns in the city, they were able to prove that they could take on workload day one. They came in as practitioners. And that's a challenge that we have with people who come in maybe from, you know, different, you know, academic backgrounds is, you know, maybe they know a lot of theory, but they've never put their hands on the keyboard and operated some of this technology. So, I mean, I just found that immensely valuable. And as NPower continues to evolve and we have programs like the ATCC, it's going to be even more successful and it's going to help me fill that need. So talent that I can't find is going to be, it's going to be the same across the panel, you know, cloud, SaaS, you know, security service edge, web isolation, you know, the DevSecOps, right? There are these areas that, you know, some are newer than others, but there's a really, you know, tough talent crunch right now. And it's kind of like the build versus buy. I mean, there's only so much of this talent out there. And if you're going to be a company that goes and looks for the people who have spoken at all the conferences, there's not that many of them. There's really not that many of them. So people who are coming into, you know, out of the NPower program and want to come into the workforce, you know, they come with the basic skill sets, not just tech, but as Avni pointed out, the soft skills required as well. And I am confident we've proven time and again that we can help, you know, help begin to upskill them into some of these, you know, these more challenging areas where it's really hard to find people. And obviously that's the point of this whole program. So, you know, I want to be the biggest customer of this program. I want to attract as much talent out of this program into Citi as I possibly can.
Love it. You said soft skills, and at least for me and perhaps many of the folks listening, immediately place the ownership of that skill or that attribute on the individual. And Shani, I want to go to you and talk about that in the context of the company, providing a sense of belonging for that employee within the environment. So it's not just can they configure a firewall, but can they have a meaningful conversation of how that impacts the bottom line or the top line for the business and be part of the security culture and be part of the team?
Absolutely. You know, when we look at our DEI strategy, you know, there's the piece around hiring, right? Oftentimes companies talk about hiring, getting folks in the door. But what you just talked about is really the inclusion piece, right? So once I join an organization, do I see myself having a long-term career? Do I see myself fitting into the culture? Is the culture welcoming to me? So these are all the things that I think all of us are looking at when we think about inclusion and belonging. And do we have a workplace and an environment that is inclusive of all cultures, right? All backgrounds. You think about Google, we have 140,000 employees globally, right? So we represent dozens of communities. And so it's not a one size fits all. What works in the US from a belonging standpoint is very different from what may work in the Middle East. So we have to constantly think about what belonging means to all of our different populations. And we also have to ensure that our leaders are equipped to be able to support employees from a belonging standpoint. That's not always easy, right? So if I'm a leader in New York and I have a very dispersed team, I cannot only act as a New Yorker, I really have to act as a global citizen for the workplace to ensure that there's true belonging there.
Yep, I love that. And I wanna move into kind of upskilling. And John, you touched on it a little bit already. So I'm going to come back to you with this idea of build versus buy. Do you go and find talent that has everything? Do you find talent that has some things and can be molded? Do you fill the gap with existing folks within the company and cross-train them? Because there's a lot of new things to learn. So how do you manage that build versus buy and find the right talent and grow the right talent?
So you're coming back to me now. I apologize.
Yeah.
No, it's you know, so the build versus buy, I mean, it comes down to a few things. I mean, obviously timelines are very important, right? So if you have the luxury of time, you probably have more choices on the table. So, you know, most companies like Citi, we like to move with a sense of urgency. So oftentimes when it comes to certain areas of cybersecurity, we're in a position where we have to, you know, we have to do that quick assessment of the field. What kind of talent can we attract? How much is it going to cost us, and can we build upon it? And oftentimes that's exactly what we do, right? We understand where, you know, where the workforce is strong. We understand what we still need to, you know, in terms of upgrading the team and their skill sets. And you know what? There are periods of time where we do need to inject or partner up with, you know, different firms out there to help us fill a gap, but also teach us how to fish along the way. So we've been very successful there, but one of the things that we learned very quickly is that, you know, as you upskill people, you have to remain competitive. You know, you have to retain that talent. You have to make sure they stay interested, they stay compensated, and that they're attracting additional people, you know, to your firm. You know, that was something that we did very well with this year on my team. We were able to, you know, hire some folks who were, you know, they had some influence out there and some experience. And I said, listen, we like working here. Here's why we like working here. You should work here too. And, you know, leveraging those informal networks has been, you know, very important for us, especially when it's come to recruiting, you know, diverse talent.
And as somebody who has gone through the program, Avneet. I'm wondering how or what message you can convey to organizations that may or may not be looking in the right place or for the right folks. How can they get the right team in place or the individuals in place and help them grow in their career?
One thing I can say is that this is the future of work. You know, COVID has forced a lot of people to work remote, but this is the future of work. Companies have to be flexible, have to be agile. Companies cannot write in job postings for an agile workplace and then take 2 months to come back to a candidate with a yes or no for a job position. But that is pretty common. So, you know, think different. Think out of, you know, out of the box. Because the talent is, you know, we have no idea of the amount of talent out there. We're just talking about the United States. But if you look at other countries, like I come from India, 50% of the Indian population, which is a billion, 50% is under the age of 35. There's a million young people entering the workforce every month. You know, there is enormous talent globally. So, and we're talking about companies, you know, on this panel and who are listening, they are global companies. So there's a lot of talent out there to be harnessed, to be improved, to be bought, but also to be really understood. So there's a lot of potential. I think that's what I have to say.
And Larry, I want to turn to you on this point of upskilling folks. So, and let's look specifically at employees are working from home remotely, and that changes how you have to manage cybersecurity and the skills that those folks need. How have you pivoted to ensure that your team has stayed up to date on the things they need to be aware of?
Sure. So a few things. I'll start at the sort of the front end of the question at the build versus buy. If we want to be a going concern for the long haul, people become the most important element of that. And therefore the notion of building is incredibly important. You gotta buy, you have to inject skills into the organization, as John indicated. You just always must do that. But people in the organization must first and foremost feel that this is a place where they can grow, that this is a place where they can fulfill their aspirations. Or you'll just be running a mercenary army and everybody will just be looking to run at the first possible opportunity because this organization couldn't care less about me. So there's got to be some thought in the strategy. And then building on that foundation, then you can put a number of tactics in place that really help with attrition, help with training, help with management. But I stress the foundation's got to be there, because if it isn't, no one's going to trust any of the things that you do. Now, I have the advantage, I guess, of thinking that this mobility and work from home, for me, it's not a revolution. The pandemic has really been a catalyst to an evolution that's been occurring for quite some time. Look at all the work we've been doing, moving stuff to the cloud. We're no longer together. Look at our agile teams spanning the world. We have teams in India and Uruguay and Colombia and Chicago and Toronto, and you know, we're no longer together. I used to be on a plane Monday through Friday, 51 weeks a year. I'm not in the office. So the whole notion of the pandemic for us, it's been a catalyst, which forces us to think a little bit more deeply about it, but it's not a revolution in that sense. So now thinking about the processes, it's really about going through and saying, can we motivate people from home? That's not the question for us. Can we do performance valuations from home? That's really not the question. The question for me really is, you can't predict where people are going to be. And therefore, can you build processes that are not dependent on their location? You can't say, we're just going to do it from home because they might be in the office. You can't say they're going to do it in the office because they might be home. It's how do you build processes that are location independent? They might be at a client site. They might be at home. They might be in the office. They might have been in the office yesterday, but not today. And all of the people processes and the business processes we have still need to work, given that flexibility that's occurring in the new normal.
But I'm going to quickly, before we go to kind of like the final thought for the future, I want to go to Shani. Your view on this in the context of partnership and relationships. So leveraging people within the company as mentors, sponsors, leveraging organizations like NPower to kind of help you tackle some of these challenges.
Yeah, I would say, you know, I think for any talent, people, DEI strategy to work and be effective, it really does take a village, right? So Google cannot accomplish what Google wants to accomplish by itself. We need partners. We need university. We need organizations that can help us understand advocacy of the communities that are within our four walls. We need universities to build out STEM education so that we can have a diverse pool. We need organizations like NPower that really focus on technical talent, diverse technical talent, helping with upskilling so that we can meet the demands of the market. So I think all organizations or all successful organizations recognize that there's always going to be a strong need for partnership and different types of partnership. Like I said, from an advocacy, from a talent perspective, and really to support what you're trying to do long term. So, you know, we continuously look at what partnerships will help us meet that business strategy. We know that the market is changing. We know that what employees want are changing. And so we have to think about professional development, advocacy, all those different things in an ecosystem that really helps us, you know, get to our end goal.
I like that, Shani. And we often forget, why are we doing this, right? And ultimately it's for the business, and then business provides some value back to society, presumably. And so we have to remember why we're doing this, and hopefully that'll inspire people to want to be part of what we're doing, not just from a cybersecurity perspective, but from an organization perspective. There are questions coming in, so we're going to get to those in a moment. I have one final question. It's going to be the same one for each of you. Just a quick round robin. What does the future hold for hiring in whatever the new normal looks like? What do we need to change from the organizational perspective, from the candidate perspective, to be diverse and equitable and inclusive in our bringing people into this industry? And Vineet, I'm going to start with you.
So I can speak from a student perspective, you know, to everybody listening out there who are NPAR students or prospective students. NPAR is a great opportunity. It is a relatively short-term commitment, but if you give it your all, the rewards are numerous. It is cutting edge technology, certifications that are at the front of the line and certifications that industry is looking for, and really puts you in a place where you can get a strong head start to your career. So that's what I have, because I've been blessed to go through NPower. I talk about NPower every opportunity I can. I've had a lot of colleagues who, even though they might have left the city, have come back asking me, can I connect them with NPower? Because they realize the talent NPAR provides. And I sometimes see, you know, like I always encourage new students that this is one of the best things you will do for yourself and for your family. So don't underestimate it. I've told students that when they go speak at career fairs, you know, be proud to be, say you're an NPAR student, you know, because they might feel intimidated that, oh, you're, you know, there's Ivy League students, and I haven't been to university, but recruiters know NPower, especially in the East Coast recruiting circuits I've been to when I was looking for positions. People know NPower, and their ears perk up. They're like, okay, yeah, I know. They have a sense of your caliber when you say you are an NPower graduate. So be proud of that, use that, leverage that, and just give it your all.
maybe and there was a question, and we'll probably come back to it for Larry, is what does it mean to be awesome at something, or what was the question? But maybe that's it. It'd be proud of the work that you've done at NPower. Shani, I want to go to you, the future of hiring.
Well, first, I want to make sure Avneet doesn't talk to any more recruiters. So, you know, while I'd like to take you out for a cup of coffee tomorrow, if you don't mind. Listen, there's so much to say about it, but what I'd like to go with right now is I think the future is organizations like NPower and companies like all of ours and their partnerships with them, right? To fund them, to support them, to help them, to teach them, and then to get the prize, get access to the great people that come out of that program and make them part of your companies, make them part of your culture. I think it's a competitive advantage. And I think there's potentially, you know, some companies that haven't thought about it that way yet. I think they'll need to be competitive in the future.
Well said, John. Shani.
I would say STEM education and STEM careers continues to be the wave of the future. Right. If you look at what we're going through from a pandemic perspective, healthcare workers, which are also STEM field, have been at the forefront. If you look at technology jobs, they've been at the forefront. And so for NPower students that are in the STEM field, the world is really your oyster, right? We are looking for you all, right? You have the pick of the litter. And so be mindful of that, be wise about the choices that you're making from a career perspective. And I think from an employer perspective, it makes it that much harder, if I must be honest, right? It makes it that much harder for us as we are looking at candidates, and we have to work that much harder in order to meet that demand from a hiring perspective. The other piece is you truly have to think about talent from a global perspective now. Gone are the days that you can only think about regions or cities. You have to look at the full talent landscape. And so that is actually a positive thing, in my opinion, for many of the companies that are on this panel, is that we have a much broader reach as we are thinking about talent and the talent landscape.
Excellent. And the future from you, Larry, and then we're going to, for everybody listening and participating, the Q&A is open. I'm going to hit that list as soon as Larry gives us his vision for what's coming.
So I really think the future looks bright. There are a number of things that are intersecting that are really interesting to me. So you've got the whole social justice movement going on, which quite frankly forces people to stop ignoring slices of the population that they were very comfortable ignoring and blaming that population for being ignored at the same time. Then you've got a pandemic, which, as terrible as it is forcing us as organizations to really take a look at how we recruit, how we retain, and how we pay attention to the aspirations of our people. And then you get this whole mobility space accentuated by a pandemic, which now doesn't require you to fly to New York for the job interview. We've now hired millions of people without them ever having set foot in a facility. And that allows people who've had family obligations, who probably couldn't fly across the country somewhere, who companies wouldn't even have looked at them because they didn't want to fly them there. That whole mobility space has exploded. You put those three things together in my mind, in addition to a few others, and you get a place where we can be seen as candidates more effectively than we could before. We get a place where we'll be listened to, I think, more than we were before. And I believe the future is bright for candidates, and we need to take advantage of that opportunity, get prepared, get involved with programs like NPower, do the work necessary to make oneself attractive to the organizations. Completely agree with Shani that STEM is hugely important, but the future is bright.
Future is bright. And I'm going to go to, there were a few questions here. There was one that stood out to me. There's one I'm holding to the end. There's one that stood out to me. How do you balance hiring manager expectations for hiring the most skilled, ready-to-work talent with the importance of hiring diverse candidates who may come from non-traditional backgrounds, may not have, quote unquote, everything that you're looking for? Now, don't all raise your hands at once for answering this, but whoever wants to jump on it, just signal and I'll go forward, just chime in.
Ma'am, I'm happy to jump in because it's a question that has bothered me many, many times in many, many rooms. But we immediately go to the notion that minority talent is not as qualified. And I just reject that notion completely. Right? We are removing barriers that have allowed us to feel comfortable ignoring people who couldn't get into organizations. And the removal of those barriers is really, really good for us. We will find people who are in some cases not as qualified. It's not because they're minorities. Some cases they'll be minorities, and other cases they won't be minorities. And we simply have to determine, as we look for talent everywhere, what's the level of preparation? Let me give you an example. In the old days, when SAP was hot, we would go out there and we wouldn't find people who had all of the SAP certifications necessary. We didn't say, well, we're hiring lesser qualified people because they're Black or they're Latino, et cetera. We simply recognized that there were things we had to do to fill the pipeline with the SAP talent that we needed to have an effective SAP practice. And the same is true here. We have to have different approaches, different techniques. We have to remove the barriers. But above all else, we have to stop behaving as if hiring women into IT and hiring minorities into IT automatically means that we're lowering the standard. And what can we do to help these poor people succeed in the organization because they're not as good? This is so far from the truth, and it really makes a mockery of the initiatives that we put in place to be successful. The truth is, we need women in IT, we need minorities in IT, because those people are also going to make our organization stronger and better.
Cheers to that, Larry. Anybody else want to comment on it?
It's hard to top Larry there.
I know. Well, let's shift it to another question then about mentorship. And perhaps it's building a community within and outside. I know a lot of you give back to NPower, and NPower certainly gives back to you. Talk to me a little bit about mentorship. The specific question is, how important is a mentor to continued growth and success? They didn't mention success for the company or the individual or the team, so I'll leave that open to you. How important is mentorship and what role does it play?
Oh, Sean, I'll talk about, you know, mentorship even just from my own career. When I look back, and I'm an HR professional, I've worked in pharmaceutical industry, I've been in aerospace and defense, and I've been now in the tech industry. And when I look at those that were mentors for me, every time I made a decision about my career or thought about moving to another organization or was brought to an organization, I could always go and talk to my mentor first. That person was the individual that could give me sound counsel and advice. They would also balance, you know, work with what I was trying to do personally and just really play that shepherd role of, you know, things that I should be thinking about with any organization, how to navigate some written and unwritten rules as an African-American woman in each of those industries. And so I think mentors play an exceptional role from a retention perspective, growing and developing talent within organization, and really also being an active ear of how employees are thinking, right? So if I said to my mentor, hey, I'm not really feeling welcomed or included on this team, that individual could move barriers, remove barriers, or have conversations that I would not be aware of. And so if you think about that in the context, again, of inclusion and a talent strategy, it is critically important for organizations to have an environment where mentorship is welcomed. So, you know, I'm a strong advocate of mentorship because I've seen what it's done for my career. I've seen what it's done for others. And it's just critical to the talent strategy.
Thank you for sharing that, Shawnee. And we're coming close to the end of time here. So I have one question that I've been holding. I don't know. I'm looking at the time here. We have some time, maybe. All right. So we have time. Maybe one more question. There was one that was much, much more pointed. Then I'm going to get to the final one, I promise. One more pointed question on what it takes to, or specifically how long it takes to hire somebody. And perhaps folks can talk a little bit about that process and maybe how that process has changed. Has it increased in time because we're remote and talent looks different, or has it improved because of it? John, you want to take that?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's within my organization. I think we have a lot of room to improve further, but I like to think that we've taken some steps. And you know, when we in the past, it was a very siloed approach to, you know, you posted a rec as a manager and you had, you know, somebody in your organization do the first interview, the second interview. And long story short, that kind of like could progress two or three times. And ultimately, maybe they're not a good fit for that job, but maybe they were a really great fit for the manager who is in the group next to yours. And we have to do a better job looking out for each other. And we've gotten a little better at that during the pandemic. I think, you know, we realized that, hey, those water cooler conversations were going to happen a bit less. So we need to put a little bit more structure around how we share resumes. You know, how do we share resumes? How do we stay aware of each other's open positions? How do we help recruit for each other to make sure that we are, you know, filling the recs, right, that we have out there, which has, you know, been a challenge. So, you know, that's one of the things that's been very helpful for us. And certainly, I'll say it again, always tapping into NPower, you know, whenever you get a chance. And I think, you know, all the folks from the different organizations that joined this webinar today, you know, you should be thinking about how you can benefit, you know, by partnering with NPower, right? Volunteering yourself and you know, providing people coming out of these programs with opportunities.
And Avneet, there's another question on vetting, and is that possible to do properly, I'll say, offline or virtually? And I want to broaden that question a little bit for you, because what that says to me in that question is, how do we know somebody is trustworthy, that we can get from them what we hope to get from them, and they're telling us what they say is true? So it's almost like, how do we have somebody or some entity vouch for this individual? And I'm wondering your experience in the power of NPower for that. For you mentioned, be proud of that, right? How can candidates and other potential people looking for a job leverage that work from NPower or elsewhere to kind of help with that vetting process?
So you're asking that how can NPower graduates leverage that process?
Yes.
Definitely going back to NPower, volunteering your time. You know, most people who have mentors don't realize that their mentors have mentors. So if you want to get ahead, you know, giving back to NPower is one of the biggest things you can do for your career. It's a little time consuming, but it's worth it. So take advantage of what you came out of. And NPower is always taking feedback from its alumni. But going back to NPower and volunteering is definitely a good way to even stand out in your organization. Does that answer your question?
Yes, it does. It does. All right. So now we are at the time, and I know Roland has a few things to say, but I'm going to make you wait a second, Roland, because there was a question that I've been holding, and it's for Larry. Others can jump in if they have a moment to share something here as well. But you said earlier, be famous for something. And the question from the group online was, what can you share with us to inspire us for a way to be famous for something?
That's a tall order, but yeah, we'll give it a shot. Everyone can be famous for something, right? Some people will be, you know, leaders of the free world and everybody will know their name. Others will really be able to inspire small groups of people. So a couple of things I would say when I be famous for something. One, there is subject matter that you can master that will make you famous. Whatever it is, you're in cyber, are you known for how well you do threat intelligence? Are you known for your depth of understanding of attack organizations? Are you known for your ability to make process work so that from, you know, the vendor valuation process all the way through, they just know, you know, call you. You can make it work like no one else can because you put the effort, the time, and you're famous for this. As you grow in your career, are you speaking about that? Are you putting something on social media where your name becomes associated with that? I ask people sometimes when they Google you, what do they find? And that's what I mean by be famous for something. But there's another area of it I'll close quickly, and that is the whole notion of how you work with people also makes you famous. Do people know you're someone who listens? Do they know that you're someone who can be trusted and be depended on? You know, do they look to you for advice and counsel? Do they trust that you're going to get it done? Those things are equally as important as being a great cyber person. And putting them together, you can be really famous.
Lived up to the order, Larry. that's phenomenal. I like the two-prong approach there for what you do and who you are. Love it. So I want to thank everybody, especially the panelists, for joining for this conversation. Thank you for bringing everything to bear that you did with hiring, retaining, managing attrition, upskilling, and giving us a peek into what the future holds. And thank you, John, Larry, Shawnee, and Avneet. Roland, I'm actually going to pass the ball back to you for the final words. Thanks, everybody.
I appreciate it. Thank you so much, Sean. Excellent job. And thank you to our panelists. If we were in an auditorium, this is when I would say everyone just give you a round of applause. So virtually, we're giving you applause, some great answers, insight, and perspectives. And again, thank you for your time that you've dedicated to prepare and make this a rewarding and worthwhile event. So I'd also like to say thank you to our attendees this evening. Thank you so much for taking the time out to hear about what our panelists had to say, to gain some insight, perspectives, and hopefully some nuggets of wisdom that you could take back to your organization. We had a great event this evening, and what I'm looking forward to do is at least follow up with these conversations and allow us to have an opportunity to explore how we may be able to collaborate. And as one of the topics came up earlier today about the future, you know, how can we incorporate you all in the future of the young adults and the veterans that we serve? And how might we incorporate you in part of that brain, the fabric of this work that we do? We're committed to creating pathways for young adults, veterans, and their spouses. Our program is free to our trainees. The expense of the program is covered by philanthropic support, individuals, foundations, corporate partners. And we want to invite you to be a part of our family. We want to invite you to be one of our sponsors to help ensure that we're able to continue providing value and depth of service to our trainees. So we'll be reaching out to you to explore these opportunities. And we look forward to your response being yes, or how might we be able to work together? What you're going to see is that as the sponsorships, when we have, we look for a gift from $50,000 to $250,000. What you're going to get is you're going to get a package for the value of the services that you'll be able to take advantage of, such as VIP attendance to our events and being a part of our tech pipeline for diverse talent. Employee engagement, creating opportunities for your employees to be mentors or to participate in tech fundamental seminars, to be able to deliver nuggets of wisdom to our students. And then also your brand exposure. We have social media, we have digital media. There have been a number of articles that we've appeared in, and we'd like to have you as a part of those corporate partners that we can mention and have some co-branded materials. And then also access to our annual gala, which is the hottest party in New York, as I understand. And I'm looking forward to seeing you all as participants in our gala. And also there may be other IT or IT related networking events that we'd like to have you participate in, maybe even be a panelist. At this time, I'd like to say thank you to our Advancing Tech Careers Collaborative sponsors, Accenture, AWS, Checkpoint, Guardian Life Insurance, Lockheed Martin, Palo Alto, Pure Storage, and Tanium. And in the future, I'd like to see your logo on this list so that we can consider you part of the team that's contributing to the advanced training of our NPower alumni. Last, we also have an amazing gala that's coming up, and I would encourage you to be a sponsor. We have information packets. It's in October, and we can circulate that information to you after this event. As we close, I want to recognize our ATCC board chairs. We have John Miller, who did an amazing job today. He's also our chair for the steering committee. Devin Bryan, Mignana, Coat, Dan Johnson, Sajewal Hader, Peter Hancock, Jason Hess, Stephen Murphy, Jeremiah Saulberg, and Vladimir Sikonik. Thank you for your wisdom. Thank you for your guidance. And also thank you for being a thought partner for us as we look to do good work and do more good work in our communities. So please reach out to us at info@npower.org. We would love to set some time up to talk with you, your team, your networking groups, to explore ways that we can partner and go deeper with this relationship. With that, we're at time. Again, I am so grateful for you participating with this and joining us. And if you have any questions, reach out to us. We're on social media. Definitely reach out to us on LinkedIn. And it's 5:58. We started on time. We're ending on time. Thank you.